أنت الحبيب المصطفى، أنت الأمين، يا خير خلق الله خير المرسلين.
إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء.
الحمد لله، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، أما بعد. So we are in the seerah now, at the beginning of the event for the Battle of Uhud. And as we mentioned, the Battle of Uhud is a very misunderstood battle. Many people, they don't understand the benefits, the fawaid, and the hikam, the wisdoms of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Battle of Uhud. Many people don't understand what really happened in Uhud. Even if we look at some of the books of seerah, especially the new summarized durus and seerah, they just focus on a defeat or a disobedience without looking at the whole battle. But when we look in the light of the Quran and the authentic sahih ahadith and the books of tarikh, looking at what is strong from weak, we see a lot of benefits from Uhud. Here Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is at a point where he has readied the army, he has assigned the different leaders. Mus'ab radiallahu anhu has the flag, and then you can see now the enemy. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is able to see the Quraysh. And the Quraysh, they can see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his army. Abdullah ibn Ubay, the munafiq, he has left. And from him leaving, there is a fitna now upon everybody. As you know, at a time of battle, it's a lot of stress. And when people on your side start to leave, or they become afraid or start running in a very subconscious manner, it puts a stress on a person. As we know, humans have this response of fight or flee. Either when you hit a stressful situation, a person fights or they run. And when you see people running or going back, then psychologically that triggers your response to flee. So here, the munafiq, Abdullah ibn Ubay, he has caused a big harm by leaving at the last moment. And subhanAllah, even if you look at his excuse, he said, because my opinion was not accepted. We have to take some lessons for our ummah today when we look at tariq. What did he say when they were in Medina and the Prophet ﷺ, he made the shura amongst the sahaba on what to do? Abdullah ibn Ubay, the munafiq, he had said, we stay in Medina. And when the Prophet ﷺ decided that we will go out, taking the opinion of other sahaba, he went out. So if he had a problem with that opinion, he should have never gone out. But in fact, he did. He went out all the way to where you can see the enemy. And now, as a plan to harm the Muslims, he says, oh, my opinion wasn't taken, so I'm going back. And you can tell that this was a trick. And that's why the munafiq is in the worst part of hell, worse than the kuffar. And we'll discuss this a little bit more. From the Ansar, many people rebelled against him. They were upset with him. Like Sa'ad ibn Mu'adh al-Ansari and Sa'ad ibn Rabi' al-Ansari, and they put on their armor and they were the ones ahead of the Prophet ﷺ. You look at the Ansar, they had very good qualities. That's why we must love the Ansar. Even today when you go to Medina and you see those that are from the children of Ansar, you see great akhlaq from them. Not everybody in Medina is from the children of Ansar, but those that are. The Ansar, they as a whole stepped up. And they started to refute him. But there were some from the Ansar that were tempted. And from them, there are two major tribes. Banu Salama and Banu Haritha. Banu Salama, Banu Haritha, they were not munafiqun. But seeing Abdullah ibn Ubay leave, and 300 of the 1,000 men, or more than 300, one third of the army leaving, It put a fear in their hearts, and they started to leave as well. So at this very delicate juncture, one of the Sahaba, radiallahu anhu, and we have to know the Sahaba, his name is Abdullah, Abdullah ibn Haram, and he's famous for being the father of Jabir, who is the son of Abdullah. When you read books of hadith, you will find a lot of hadith reported from Jabir ibn Abdullah. So Jabir, he is the son of Abdullah. So Abdullah, the father, great Sahabi, he is from the Ansar, and he steps up to his nation and he tells his people that you are leaving the Prophet of Allah. It is the haqq of the Prophet of Allah that we stand and fight. And he starts to refute the ideas of the munafiqun. And this man, subhanallah, Abdullah, the father of Jabir, he is a great Sahabi. He has miracles. If you look at the books of hadith, many miracles happened to him. Many karamat. He was from the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Sahaba, all of them, they were close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, those munafiqun, what did they say? They told Abdullah that if we thought there was going to be fighting, we would have stayed. But this man, يعني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, he's just taking us around. He's just giving us exercise. There's not going to be no fighting. So why waste our time? SubhanAllah. You look at the flip-flop of the munafiq. First, it was an issue of their opinion not being accepted. Second, they were afraid to fight. Why are we killing ourselves for this? Third, now they're saying, well, there's not even going to be any fighting. We're just giving us exercise. And what we as people who hope, nobody can claim I'm a mu'min, but hope to be from the believers, from the mu'minun. What lesson we should take is whatever the munafiq did, we should do the opposite. Because the mu'min and munafiq are two opposites. Even the kafir, at least he's open about being a kafir. But the munafiq, he puts on the appearance of Islam, but in his heart there is no iman. And the mu'min, he is outside as he is inside. So the munafiq, what is the first thing? They're upset, their opinion was not taken. So what should we learn? First thing, be humble. Be humble. You know when you have an opinion, you want to do something, you think something is the best way? If whoever is the Amir, whether it's the Amir of a masjid, or an Amir of a jaysh, or an Amir of a household, or the Amir of a lajna, or a shura, whoever is your Sheikh, your alim, your Amir, your leader, as long as he is in accordance with the Kitab of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, obey him. Don't think that I am the smartest person to ever live, and if my opinion is not taken, nothing can ever be right. Don't have that kibr, as Abdullah ibn Ubay, the munafiq, had. Have tawadu. Have humbleness. Man tawadu lillah rafa'ahu. Whoever has tawadu for the sake of Allah, Allah will raise them. If you give an opinion, and the Amir makes a decision, and according to something other than your opinion, think that is the best will happen. If Allah wrote it, alhamdulillah. My opinion was wrong, whatever shar was going to come from me, the Amir has saved us from. And if later something different happens, don't say, oh, Elijah, you should have said, remember I told you this, if you had done what I said, told you so. Because this is the work of the munafiq. That's what Abdullah ibn Ubay is doing here. First thing. Second thing, never be afraid. They were like, look, why are we here? There's 3,000, we're 1,000. But look at Badr. Look at the witness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And today we find the same thing. The Muslim ummah, they're in general just afraid. Whether they admit it or not, hearts are filled with fear. And when they see somebody brave, instead of supporting them, instead of saying, you know, subhanallah, maybe I can't do it, but I'm going to stand behind somebody who can. Instead, they want to point excuses. They want to find faults. They want to throw labels. Something we're seeing in our ummah today, so I have to address it. And third, never think something is for nothing. Like here, the munafiqun are saying, there's not even going to be any fighting. If there is no fighting, why are you running away? Stand still, stand your ground, and Allah will reward you because of your niyyah. So even if you go out for da'wah, or if you go out and you set up a program to invite people towards Islam and nobody comes, or nothing happens, don't think it was wasted. No effort is wasted with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every dollar you spend, every penny you spend, every minute you spend, every sweat that you sweat for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will have the full reward. Allah will never take away your reward as long as you're mukhlisan lillah. So we need to learn these lessons and implement in our life. So these munafiqun, they continued to go back. And here Abdullah Abu Jabir, yani the father of Jabir ibn Abdullah, he told them, and this is in Sahih al-Bukhari, and this also comes in the tafsir of Surah Ali Imran in the 167th ayah. He told them, look, if you are too afraid to fight, it's okay. At least stand with the Prophet, stand with the believers, so the number of the Muslims will look strong. That's a beautiful advice. Look, not everybody's going to be a great speaker. Not everybody's going to be brave. Not everybody's going to be a great leader. But that doesn't mean you run away. At least stand and support somebody. What do we find in our ummah today? That the cowards of this ummah, those that are afraid from the makhluk, when they see somebody standing up for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or for the deen of Islam, or for the Quran and Sunnah, or for the aqidah of Islam, immediately they want to find an excuse why they shouldn't follow. One of the clearest and obvious all the time, Wahhabi. I don't even know what this word means. But apparently it's some kind of chupacabra, blood drinking, child eating monster. Nobody goes out and saying, I'm a Wahhabi. No, there's no such thing. Look, there was a scholar. His name was Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. His name wasn't Abdul Wahhab. His name was Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. And he was a scholar who did his effort to revive the ummah, to get rid of shirk. He wrote books. You can read those books. We don't find anything wrong with his books. He called towards tawheed. He called towards not making shirk. But he didn't start a group. There's no sect for him. The before him, many ulama like Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn Al-Qayyim, and before them Imam Ahmad and Shafi'i, they called towards the same aqidah. The same manhaj. The kitab and sunnah, the sahaba called towards the same thing. So there's nothing new here, but just an excuse not to stand up for the truth. So we leave these things. We stand. And we weigh everything in the scale, in the mizan, of the kitab and sunnah. Whoever speaks in accordance to that, we follow them. That need for titles, or this madhab, or that group, or that qawm. Here, Abdullah ibn Jabir, he encouraged the sahaba who had iman, and even reminded the munafiqun, and those from Banu Salima and Banu Haritha, they took this advice and they stayed. And that's a characteristic of a believer. A believer also has fear. A mu'min is not like some kind of alien with no heart. We're not Vulcans. We have feelings. Fear comes upon us. But when the reminder from the Kitab of Allah or the Sunnah or the Salihin comes, the believer, he takes benefit from it. He changes from it. So here, these tribes, they stayed, they didn't leave. And those of the people of Nifaq, they left. And here, Abdullah, the father of Jabir, in Sahih al-Bukhari, and this hadith is reported in the Musnad and other books as well. But it's in the Bukhari, يعني, there's no shak to it being Sahih. No doubt. He tells his son Jabir, before the Battle of Badr, the night before, he tells his son that tomorrow there will be fighting. It's not going to be one of those battles where there was no fighting. And tomorrow, I will be the first one to become shaheed. Subhanallah. How did he know? Because as we will study, that is what happened. It's not that he had ilmul ghayb. No, but there are awliya. There are those from the sahaba that are very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through dreams, or through other ways, not through wahi, not through Jibreel alayhi salam, but through dreams, he lets his awliya know certain things. And that is the closeness that they have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we shouldn't go towards ghulu. I shouldn't exaggerate and think they have ilmul ghayb or they get wahi or something. No. And at the same time, we shouldn't go to the other extreme and say there is no awliya. No, there are awliya, no doubt. And how do you know a wali? He is the one most in accordance with the kitab of Allah and the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Doesn't mean some guy who's naked on some kind of grave, whipping people is a wali. No. If he isn't covering his aura, how are you going to call him a wali? Somebody doesn't make salah, how are you going to call him a wali? Somebody's dancing with music, you're going to call him a wali. This is ignorance. The wali or the awliya of Allah are the strictest in following the way of Rasulullah ﷺ. So here, Abdullah, he tells his son that tomorrow there will be fighting, there will be jihad, and I will be the first shaheed. And I hope this from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's happy about it. But he gives him nasiha. He tells him, you have sisters. And looking at the books of tariq, what is authentic is that he had 9 sisters. He was one brother with 9 sisters. That's a lot of sisters. So he said, take care of your sister. Make sure they have tarbiyah. Make sure you raise them properly. And this is a great advice for the parents to give to their children. To make sure that they take care of their siblings. And secondly, he tells him that I have debt. I owe money. And what I owe, you must repay on my behalf. Now the Sahaba, they didn't have debt because they were trying to buy 50-inch TVs or because they were trying to buy luxurious camels of the time, if we convert it to cars today. They had debt because they sold whatever they had for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I was looking at this in the books that go over the biographies of Sahaba. And it said about Abdullah, the father of Jabir, he was in debt because he sold everything and he gave everything for the sake of Allah. And then he took debt to buy armor and go and fight in Uhud. That's why they had debt. So he told him that make sure you pay off my debt. Because I heard Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that even the shaheed, even the one who's a martyr, a shaheed, he's barred from his destination until his debt is paid. That's how important it is for the debt to be paid in Islam. Here, he tells him, I have debt, make sure you pay it. And he gives him other advice. In the different narrations, he gave him more advice to have taqwa, to be firm. And we see his son Jabir, mashallah, from the mujahideen, from the ulama, from the narrators of hadith, memorizers of Quran. So you see, from a pious father, a pious child. And after that, he gets ready to go out with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now the army has been cleared of munafiqun. Yani the hypocrites are gone. And this is a very important point. Abdullah ibn Ubay and those that went with him, they were hypocrites. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran has clarified this issue. And those that stayed with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, including Abdullah the father of Jabir, including Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali and Zubair bin Awam and others, those are no doubt believers. So anybody that has doubts about this, they should read this and look at the tariq and understand that. Here, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sees the Quraysh. And now, if you go directly, the Quraysh are going to see your movement. And as you're coming, they will take advantage. They're already there set to shoot you with arrows and harm you. So here the Prophet ﷺ, he asked the Sahaba, who can get me close to them without them understanding where we're going? So one of the Sahaba, Abu Khaytama radiallahu anhu, he told the Prophet ﷺ that I'm your man. I know this area, I will get you. Abu Khaytama radiallahu anhu took Rasulullah ﷺ and the army through a back way where the mountain was covering them. Where the Quraysh saw them disappear, but they didn't know which way they're coming. And they went over some gardens. And here, and Ibn Hisham, Ibn Kathir, and others have mentioned with authentic chains, there was a blind munafiq. And a blind man who had a farm, and he was a munafiq. He was a well-known hypocrite. Even though on his appearance, he would say he's a Muslim. But he was a munafiq. So when he saw, oh, he didn't actually see, he's blind. When he was told that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Muslim army are going through your garden, your farms, he came out and instead of supporting them, he started throwing dirt on them. And this sounds strange, but if you look at the munafiqun today, they do the same thing. When they see the Muslim getting strong, they want to harm you. When a sheikh or a alim becomes famous, they want to spread some rumors about it. When a leader takes strength and the Muslims come together, they want to harm the Muslims. And that's what he did. He started throwing dirt, even though he's blind. So here, he started to tell them that in kunta Rasulullah, even if you are the Prophet of Allah, you cannot pass through my farm. I forbid it. So the young Sahaba, they became upset. You're supposed to be a Muslim. You're supposed to be helping us. You're harming us. They went for their swords to kill him. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, out of his mercy, he told him, لا تقتلوه. فهذا, يعني this منافق, أعمى القلب والأعمى البصر. He says, don't kill him. Because this man, he is blind of the heart and blind of his eyes. You know, some people, they're blind in the eyes, but their heart sees. But some people, they have eyesight, but their hearts are blind. And this man was both. Now, even though he's harming the Muslims, he's harming the Prophet, he's harming the Muslim army, he's trying to get in the way of jihad, it was the right of the Prophet that could have killed him. They were already out for battle, they're armed. But look at the peace and mercy of the Prophet ﷺ. They let him live. Even though he's a munafiq. But he's blind. He's an old man. Let him live. And this should be a sign for us today. Many of the brothers that claim to be mujahideen today, but they have no such mercy in their hearts. Any chance they can kill somebody, they kill. Even if it's an old man, even if it's an old woman, even if they're children, and whoever does this, this is wrong. This is not the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is he fights those that deserve to be fought, and he leaves those that are not a harm to him. And here Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he continued. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Sahaba, they get to the other side of the Quraysh without the Quraysh realizing where they were coming from. And they get a good location. In the location where they were, the Quraysh was between them and Medina, and a mountain to their back. So this was a very good location. And the Prophet ﷺ, by using the means, he prepared the army. And he assigned 50 archers. It's very important, as many of you already know. 50 archers, a squad of 50 archers, under the command of Abdullah ibn Jubayr. Abdullah ibn Jubayr, radiallahu anhu. Under his command, he put 50 archers, and he gave them very clear instructions. As mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari, he told them that you stay here and cover our back. Don't let riders come from behind us. And 50 archers are a strong force. And he said, even if you see us victorious, winning, don't come until I send a messenger to you. And even if you see us being slaughtered, so much so that birds are ripping our bodies, I mean vultures are taking our flesh, even then, don't come to help us. It's a very important lesson. When you're given certain instructions by your Amir, follow those instructions. Sometimes even with good intention, you will do something wrong. So here, what is the command of the Prophet ﷺ to them? Stay on the hill. No matter what, until a messenger comes to you from me for you to come down, do not leave your post. And he posts them there. And then Rasulullah ﷺ, he prepares the army. With Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu. Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu, we talked about him in the earlier durus. The great Sahabi, the wealthy youth of Mecca that left his wealth for the sake of Allah, one of the first du'at sent to Medina, this young man who gave up everything for the sake of Allah, he is made as the flag bearer in the middle of the army. And to the right of him is Az-Zubayr ibn Awwam. Az-Zubayr ibn Awwam, one of the 10 given the glad tidings of Jannah, the husband of Asma bint Abi Bakr, radiallahu anha. The father of Urwa and Abdullah ibn Zubayr and other great tabi'een that come later. And on the right of him is Munzir ibn Amr radiallahu anhu, the great Sahabi as well. Now across from the believers is the Quraysh, is the Mushrikeen, and they're also preparing. So how did they set up their army? They put Khalid ibn Walid on the side facing Zubayr ibn Awwam. And they give him many of the Fursan, the horsemen, the knights. And on the side of Al-Mundir, they put Ikrama ibn Abi Jahl. So now Zubayr ibn Awwam is on the left for the Muslim side. So Khalid ibn Walid, who is a mushrik at this time, even though Allah guides him later, he is on the right because that is facing the left. And Ikrama is on the left of the Quraysh, which is facing the right, which is Al-Mundir, on the side of the believers. Now, the flag of Islam, and we mentioned the three flags, but the main one is given to Mus'ab ibn Umair. But who has the flag of the Quraysh? The Quraysh traditionally gave the flag to Banu Abd al-Dar. Banu Abd al-Dar was a qabila from Quraysh, and traditionally they had the flag. So they were given the flag. But Abu Sufyan, and later on he becomes a Muslim, radiallahu anhu, but at the time he is a mushrik. So he goes to them and he tells them that if you are able to handle it, give us the flag. Give it to Banu Hashim, or another qabila will take it from the Quraysh. Now this is a very tricky thing, because one, he has now angered them, but in an anger that will be beneficial for him, because now their ghira, their honor, is triggered. And they're like, what? You think we can't handle the flag? He said, we will not let the flag fall, no matter what, even if all of us die. So now, he's playing his politics. He's getting the targheeb for his own army. So now they are fired up. That no way are we going to be dishonored by somebody taking the flag from us, we will defend it. Then Abu Sufyan, he plays another trick. And this is a trick that's been played with us today. He goes, and now the Sahaba can hear him. And he announces, Ya Mashar al-Ansar, O people of Ansar, O people of Medina, we have no problem with you. We have no fight with you. Why are you here getting yourselves killed for nothing? Our problem is with the children of our uncles, yani our relatives. Those people who made hijrah from Mecca, those Quraysh. So let us deal with them. You guys, just stay out of it. And subhanAllah, that trick is used today. You know, if a Muslim in certain Muslim country gets into a hardship, they say, oh, it's an Arab issue. Oh, it's a between Afghan issue. Oh, you are Pakistani, you are Afghani, why are you worried about it? Oh, you are Somali, this is an Ethiopian issue. The Sudani issue. No, the Muslim Ummah is one Ummah. The issue of any one Muslim is the issue of every single Muslim. Doesn't matter if you're Arab or Ajam or white or black or rich or poor. We are one Ummah. The Prophet ﷺ told us that the example of this Ummah is like one body. If one part is in pain, the whole body feels that pain and restlessness and not being able to sleep and going through that hardship. You know when your arm, when your hand hurts, when you have a real harsh pain in your hand, you can't tell the rest of the body, let the hand deal with it, I'm going to go to sleep. You get a toothache, you can't tell the body, it's a tooth, mouth issue, don't worry about the brain, go to sleep. The whole body feels it. We're one body, one ummah. We have to feel it together. And the Ansar, they stepped up. When you read Tariq, we love the Ansar. They stepped up and they told the Quraysh, they told the Mushrikeen that wallahi, the Prophet is dearer to us than our children, than our parents, than our tribe, than our people. We will defend him more than even those that came with him. Beautiful answers. And I'm summarizing from many poems that they read and answers that they gave, but a very brave answer. They didn't let nationalism or tribalism divide them. Then Abu Sufyan played another trick. This is a trick also being played with us today. So pay attention. There was a man, and we discussed him already in the early durus. His name is Abu Amir al-Rahib. He used to be called Abu Amir the pious man, the man who was a zahid, rahib. They didn't care about dunya. And we spoke about him, that he was from Medina, and he was an early Christian in Medina. And he was known for not loving the dunya and being very, what would be apparently, pious. But when the Prophet ﷺ came and his da'wah came, Abu Amir al-Rahib, he fought the Prophet ﷺ. Why? Even though what the Prophet ﷺ brought was haq, but he fought him because of one kibr. He wanted that he should be the one that leads this revolution towards Zuhud. Why does somebody else need to do it? And this is the problem today. You will see an alim or a leader building a community, benefiting the people, and another alim, he will hate him just because of jealousy. Why him? Who the hell is he? Why does it matter? Every one of us should have the attitude that it doesn't matter about me. It matters about the da'wah, about the calling towards Allah and His Prophet ﷺ. Even if I'm not remembered anymore, even if I'm gone, even if nobody knows my name, but the banner of the Kitab of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and the Aqidah of Islam is taken and rises, no matter who takes it, no matter if he's white or black or Arab or Ajam, no matter what he is, if he can take that banner, that's what makes me happy. And I'll take my seat in the back. You know, in Salahuddin Ayyubi, he was Kurdish, he wasn't Arab. When he called towards jihad, many people, they went with him. When they heard about Redbeard from Germany coming with his huge army, many of those people, they became afraid. What did they say? What? He's not even Arab. He's Kurdish. How can he lead us? Why not? He didn't get any copyrights, leadership. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises somebody because of their knowledge or their zuhud or their bravery, whatever reason Allah gave them, let them lead and follow them, no matter who they are. And this trick, here the Quraysh, they use. They had Abu Amir Rahib. And the Prophet ﷺ changed his name to Abu Amir Al-Fasiq. Instead of Rahib, Al-Fasiq. And even though he was a Zahid, he continued to be very, what we would say, apparently pious. But when he fights the truth, then that piety is not piety. And it's a very important lesson today. Because today sometimes we see somebody crying a lot, or making a lot of dua, and making a lot of salah, and we think this guy's on haq. And then maybe he's calling you towards shirk. Maybe he's calling you towards bid'ah. And you think, no, but look at him. He looks so pious. But if he fights the haq, then that's not piety. And that's why Abu Amir al-Rahib was called Abu Amir al-Fasiq. So Abu Sufyan uses him, as the kuffar use today, people against us as well. And they have him go. And they have him call out to his tribe. And he's from Al-Aws. Al-Aws from the Ansar, from the people of Medina. And he calls out, O people of Aws, O people of Medina, it is me, Abu Amir al-Rahib, your leader. Somebody that you love, somebody you know to be pious, and I'm telling you, leave this man, yani Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and come follow us, and this, and this, and this, and he does his propaganda. And now, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he doesn't allow any of the Quraysh to answer him. He points out the Ansar. And from the Ansar, Al-Aws, his own tribe, they get up and they say, Ya Abu Amir, Ya Abu Amir al-Fasiq. They call him al-Fasiq straight. Said, we have nothing to do with you. You have turned away from the truth. And no matter if you're from our tribe, no matter if you're from our people, we have no bonds with you. We are going to stand with Allah and His Messenger and the truth today, even if every one of us is killed. Beautiful answer from Al-Ansar. So what does Abu Amir say? He turns to the Quraysh and he says, after I left my people, they've become people of Sharia. And that's what you see today. You know, when you call towards truth, people say, you're causing problems. You know, when you tell somebody, I think this is a bid'ah, brother, why are you causing Sharia? I'm not. I'm bringing the haq. I'm telling you, qala Allah and qala Rasul. The people of bid'ah are bringing Sharia. You know, you go to certain masajid, and you pray in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, everybody's going to want to fight you. Everybody's going to tell you, don't do it. Why? You're going to cause shara. No! If I'm following the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I'm bringing the truth. When you fight that way, you're causing shara. Here the Ansar and the Aws are not bringing shara. They are standing with Qala Allah, Qala Rasul. They are standing with the Kitab and Sunnah. Abu Amir, he is the fasiq bringing shara. He is the troublemaker. He is the one causing the problems. So we should be careful of these tricks even today. Abu Amir, I want to mention a little bit about him. As we study these people, we should know. Abu Amir al-Fasiq, this man was apparently very pious. And when he was in Medina, and the da'wah of Prophet ﷺ was growing, he told the Prophet ﷺ one time, and it's a sahih hadith, he told the Prophet ﷺ that whichever one of us is on haq, may Allah make him victorious. And whichever one of us is on batil, whichever one is on the falsehood, then may Allah give him a destroyed death away from everybody, like he's alone somewhere. So the Prophet ﷺ, he told him, Ameen. Okay, that's what you want. So here, Abu Amir, years later, after Uhud, I'm skipping ahead just to tell you about it. He tries to go to the area of Tabuk to get the Romans, who are also Christian, to get an army against the Prophet ﷺ. And when he's going, and he's speaking, and he's causing these problems on those paths, at one time, he goes out for Qada al-Hajah. Qada al-Hajah, to answer the call of nature. Sahih Hadith. He goes out to answer the call of nature, and an animal. Some of the ulama, they said it was a snake, some said a scorpion, Allah knows best. But some kind of a natural animal bites him, and he dies on top of his own, well, you know what, alone, away from everybody. His own dua came against him. And this is what we see. The people of batil, even if apparently they're doing good, in the end, the haq will always prevail. Abu Amir Fasiq is not able to deal with this issue either. So now, Abu Sufyan moves to his fourth trick. He goes to the women. And as we mentioned, some of the ulema said 8, some said 12, but maybe 15, depending on the numbers. But the Quraysh had brought women with them. So he goes to the women and he tells them to read songs or poetry and bring music. And they actually had music with them and sing and dance and encourage the army. And the Muslims, their way, even during battles, is not to sing and dance. It's to read Quran, to give talks based on the Quran and Sunnah, to remind about Akhirah, talk about Jannah, talk about Jahannam. You know who uses music to incite people other than us? You know who uses this? The Kuffar. They are the ones who bring music and instruments and singers to try to encourage people. And today our Muslim brothers, they want to follow that path. We were talking to somebody about da'wah and calling towards Allah. And he said, you know, your lectures are so boring. You need to have some music. You need to have some singing, some dancing, and some encouragement. Get a rapper to be with you, then you'll become famous. Jazakallah khair. I'd rather not be famous. And that's what the Quraysh did. They brought singing and dancing, and the women, they sang, and they said things like, if you fight these people today, we will put out the bedding and the mats for you, and we will come to you, and we will be happy with you, and if you don't, then we will leave you, and this, and this, and this. And they got the people angry. So Abu Sufyan, he's using the media now, he's using his techniques to go forward. On the other hand, what is the Prophet ﷺ doing? And we talked about what the Quraysh and the Mushrikeen are doing. Is the Prophet ﷺ also saying, well, if they're using that, let us use it? No. What the Prophet ﷺ did, he took a sword. It's a sahih hadith. And he said, who will take this sword from me with and fulfill its haqq, fulfill its right? Here, Az-Zubayr ibn Awwam, he steps up. He says, Ya Rasulullah, I will take it. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doesn't answer him. He continues to say, who will take the sword from me and fulfill its right? Here, Ali ibn Abi Talib, Umar ibn Khattab, other Sahaba, they step up. They say, we will take it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doesn't say anything to them. He continues to say, who will take the sword from me and fulfill its haqq? And then a Sahabi, Abu Dujana. Yes, Abu Dujana, Ansari, radiallahu anhu. He steps up and he says, O Messenger of Allah, what is the haqq of this sword? Subhanallah. Many of the ulama, they said, why did the Prophet give it to him particularly? Because he was the first one to ask that question. And it teaches us the importance of knowledge and learning and understanding. When you tell somebody, go do this, at least learn how to properly do that first. So he asked, what is the haqq of this sword? So the Prophet ﷺ tells him, the haqq of this sword is that you strike the faces of your enemy until it bends. Abu Dujana radiallahu anhu says, O Messenger of Allah, I will take this sword and I will fulfill the haqq of this sword. And he takes the sword. We're going to talk about Abu Dujana later as the battle goes on. But I want to tell you something about this Sahabi, radiallahu anhu. This Sahabi, he was well known that when he put on a red cloth, it wasn't a blood, don't get carried away. When he put on a red cloth and he tied it, it was a sign to let everybody know that he will not stop fighting until he becomes shaheed. There is no going back. And when he took the sword, he started walking with his chest out, shoulders back, in a strut that looked like an arrogant walk. He started walking in that manner that looks like arrogance. And the Prophet ﷺ said in the Sahih Hadith that this is the type of walk that Allah hates except in this condition. And that's a very important pointer for us. You know, sometimes when you're standing for the haqq and there is a time, you need to be brave. You need to be confident. You need to step up. And somebody may see that as kibar, but that's not kibar. That's why the Prophet ﷺ in Tawaf, you know, he would show the shoulder to show the strength. That's why the Prophet ﷺ would go one way and Eid and come back a different way. That sometimes you have to have that show of force. Or you have to stand up. You're not always going to be like, Some people think this is piety. Some people came in the time of Umar ibn Khattab. They came to the masjid and they were going, And they were shaking hands. You know, like today, some of the Muslim scholars, dua, they shake hands and like, sound like, Alhamdulillah. How are you? Can't speak? What happened? Umar radiallahu anhu told him, what's wrong with you guys? They said, no, we're just being pious. Umar radiallahu anhu took a stick, he hit them. Umar is Umar. He hit them, he tells them the place for piety is here. It's the heart. Many people, they're like, brother, alhamdulillah. And in their heart, kibr is above the mountains. If you have tawadu, Allah will show it. Don't try too hard. Here, Abu Dujana, he takes the sword. And we'll talk about it later. But Zubayr bin Awam and other Sahaba, they followed him to see why Rasulullah gave him the sword and what was the haqq. And we'll talk about how he fought in Uhud. And later, you will see him throughout Seerah. Even when we talk about the death of Musaylim al-Kadhab, it was between Abu Dujana and Wahshi radiallahu anhuma that Musaylim al-Kadhab is killed. So you see him and Mujahid continuously. Now, the fighting begins. Now, the flag bearer from Quraysh. You know, we said, who had the flag here? Mus'ab ibn Umayr. But the flag bearer for Quraysh, he steps up. and his name is Talha ibn Abi Talha al-Abdari. Talha ibn Abi Talha was a wrestler. Physically, he was very strong. And he was a known fighter. He was one of the trained soldiers of Quraysh. He used to be called the Ram. You know a ram? He was called the Ram of the army. Because the rest of the soldiers looked like sheep. And he looked like a ram. Physically. And you know how a ram hits you hard? Abu Talha, or Talha ibn Abu Talha, this mushrik from Quraysh, he was known that when he would hit you, it would be so hard that you felt like a ram hit you. He steps up with a sword, and he steps towards the Muslims, and he tells them, who will fight me today? And many of the Sahaba even, they were hesitant, because this man was a very strong and known warrior. And he was riding a camel. So he wasn't even on foot. So when you're on foot, you can fight, but if somebody's riding an animal, it's hard to even take them down. But here, one of the greatest of the Sahaba, one of the 10 given the glad tidings of Jannah, one of the Sahaba that all of us don't know enough about, Zubair, Al-Zubair ibn al-Awwam, radiallahu anhu, he steps up, and he rushes him. And I was reading some of the books. It said it looked like how a lion attacks a camel and throws him. He rushes him on foot. Zubair ibn Awwam, even though he is physically smaller. All our gym addicted brothers. Physically, Zubair ibn Awwam, he's not as strong. He's smaller, he's weaker. But he jumps up and he drops Talha ibn Abi Talha from his camel, drops him down, cuts his head. Kills him. Like that. Like a lion. If he's a ram, Zubair ibn Awwam is a lion. Takes him down. And the flag of Quraysh, it falls. And here the Prophet ﷺ, in the Sahih Hadith, he says, Allahu Akbar. He says, Takbir, Allahu Akbar. And this is what the Muslims should say at times of happiness. Not that, la-la-la-la-la, clapping, none of that stuff. Takbir, Allahu Akbar. Don't watch those Hollywood movies too much. Reality is what we find in the Sahih Hadith. And the Prophet ﷺ says something beautiful, as mentioned by Al-Bukhari and Muslim, Al-Tirmidhi ibn Majah, no doubt Sahih Hadith. فَقَالَ النَّبِيَ عَلَيْهِ سَلَاتُ السَّلَامُ إِنَّ لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍ حَوَّارِيًا وَإِنَّ حَوَّارِي الزُّبَيْرِ بِنْ عَوَّامٍ. SubhanAllah, beautiful glad tidings. He says, for every Nabi, there is a special companion. Special companion for him. And verily, my Hawari, my special companion, is Zubair ibn Awwam. You know, look at the glad tidings. He's from the 10 given glad tidings of Jannah. He was married to Usman ibn Abi Bakr. He's a lion in this battle. We don't even know about him. This is sad. So he's given this glad tidings by the Prophet ﷺ. And the flag of Quraysh falls. And right at that time, Talha ibn Abi Talha's brother, another mushrik from Quraysh, his brother, his name is Uthman ibn Abi Talha, he goes, he runs, he jumps, grabs the flag. He picks up the flag of Quraysh. And here, another lion from the lions of Allah, Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib, radiallahu anhu, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he attacks him like a lion and cuts him. Subhanallah, Hamza, radiallahu anhu. When he cut him, as the books of Tariq mention, he cut him from his neck, cutting off his arm and shoulder, all the way, with one blow of his sword, all the way to his belly button, to his navel. In the books, it's clear, he cut him from here, with one blow of his sword, all the way to his navel. He said we could see the side of his heart. It was split open. Cut him in half. And the flag of Quraysh falls again. Second victory for the Muslims. Then Abu Sa'd ibn Abi Abu Sa'd ibn Abi Talha, the brother, also another brother of Talha and Uthman, Abu Sa'd, they're all children of Abu Talha, all from the same family, all from Quraysh, all from Bani Abdudar. They are stepping up to the flag. He picks it up. Now here, he picks it up and he tries to be away from people. He tries to get away. And the hero of Islam, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas, radiyallahu, he takes an arrow, he shoots the arrow. And he hits him in the neck. He hits him right in the neck. Then even when he's trying to be away, he can't get away. He hits him in the neck so much that his tongue, the tongue of Abu Sa'd, comes out. And he falls, and the flag falls again. Third victory for the believers. Now, with these three dead, all their brothers dead, the son of Talha, Talha ibn Abi Talha, the mushrik from Quraysh, his son Musafi', Musafi' is the son, Musafi' ibn Talha ibn Abi Talha, he takes the flag. His father was the first one killed. He takes the flag, and here Asim ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu jumps up, the great Sahabi, Asim ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu, he jumps up, he fights him, kills him. Fourth victory for the believers. Then Kilab, the other brother of Musafi' and the son of Talha, he grabs the flag for Quraysh. And here Zubayr ibn Awam, again Zubayr ibn Awam radiallahu anhu goes, fights him, kills him. Five down. Then their brother Al-Jallas ibn Talha, ibn Abi Talha, he grabs the flag. And here the ulama, there is khilaf. Some of them said that Talha ibn Ubaidullah killed him. And some of them said that Asim ibn Thabit again killed him. The stronger opinion seems like Talha ibn Ubaidullah, but this is a historical issue. So now, six of the Quraysh that all stepped up have all lost in their battles, and six victories have come towards the believers. But now a man named Artaq, also from the same tribe within Quraysh, Banu Abdudar, he picks up the flag and he is killed, according to some of the historians, by Hamza, and others they say Ali ibn Abi Talib. But he is the seventh killed, and the Muslims are victorious every single time. Now, there is a man, he's called Shurayhi, and he picks up the flag and he is killed by a man named Quzman. Quzman, he will kill the next three people. But I want to tell you about him a little bit. The next from Quraysh that picks it up is Abu Zayd. His name is Amr ibn Abdul Manaf, and he lifts it, and he is also killed by the same man who's fighting alongside with the Muslims, Quzman. Then a third person, the son of the first, he picks it up and he's also killed by Quzman. Now there's 10 dead from the Quraysh. But Quzman, he kills three people, and the Sahaba are very happy. But what does the Prophet ﷺ say? He says he is from the people of the Nar. SubhanAllah. There's something shocking. This man, he's fighting alongside the believers. He just killed three of the Quraysh in a very brave manner, in a row. And the Prophet ﷺ said, he is from the people of the Nar. Many of the Sahaba, they became very confused about this. They became very confused about this. And I'm fast forwarding here to explain. But later on in the battle, they follow him and he kills a lot of people. He's a great warrior. Quzman, great fighter. So they become confused about this issue, and they come back to the Prophet ﷺ and they say that he has been fighting his whole battle and now he's injured and he's going to become shaheed. And you're saying he's from people of Nar? The Prophet ﷺ a second time tells them he is from the people of Nar. He will enter the Nar. They became confused. until one of the Sahaba saw him at the end of his life, after fighting in jihad and killing and being injured. The pain of the injuries got too much. He took his sword, he put it on the ground and laid on top of it. Killed himself. Suicide. And as we know, the Prophet ﷺ has told us that whoever commits suicide will enter the Nar. And if they're a mu'min, if they're a believer, they will leave it. We're not saying that they're going to be kuffar from it. But they will definitely enter the Nar. So what does this tell us? First thing, it's never okay for a Muslim to kill himself. Even if you're desperate. Even if pain and misery and weakness and hardship is coming on you, we don't find the Prophet ﷺ ever allowing a Muslim to kill himself. Now, if you attack a big group of the enemy, like Khalid bin Walid used to do, mashallah, excellent. Let them make you shaheed. If like Bara radiallahu anhu, you jump into Hadiqat al-Maut and you fight until the kuffar kill you and you're too outnumbered, it's fine. If like the child in the hadith about the boy and the king, the famous hadith, Sahih hadith, we told the king, you have to take the arrow, and the king's arrow kills you. That's fine. But to kill yourself, we don't find any ahadith for it. In fact, here, this man, he's fighting alongside, in jihad. And his pain is too much, and he kills himself. The Prophet is saying, he's from the people of Nar. The second thing he tells you, it's very scary, is that sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will use somebody, even if they are not people who are heading straight to Jannah, but He will use them for good. Uthman here, Allah used him. And there's a hadith on this, that the ulama, when they would read, it would make them cry. Every one of us should be afraid that maybe Allah will even use us for good, but we will not be from the people of Jannah. But at least not those who go directly to Jannah. So don't get overconfident, I give so much da'wah, I wrote 10 books, I gave this many lectures, I did this, I did that. No, you don't know. Always turn to Allah and make tawbah and make istighfar and look at your own weaknesses and look at your own shortcomings and ask Allah to protect you and help you. Never get overconfident. Now, in the battle, the flag has dropped of Quraysh 10 times. 10 battles, Muslims have won them every single time. Now a man named Sawab, who was a slave of Banu Abdul-Dar. He was a slave, he wasn't even from them. But to show off or to impress his masters, he steps up, he takes the flag. And he's an excellent warrior, he's a good fighter. So he makes many of the Muslims shuhada. Now he's doing well. But Hamza radiallahu anhu, the Lion of Allah, jumps on him, takes him, kills him, and the flag of Quraysh drops again. And now it has dropped where nobody is able to pick it up. Where the Muslims have now advanced and they're becoming victorious. And it's not just one-off battles, now the battle is in full force. There are battles going on all over, and the Muslims are winning. And inshallah, next Saturday, we'll continue with what happens in the rest of the battle. ففروا إلى الله ففروا